Wait, you have a TV?
No, I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide, you don't need a TV.
Hey everybody, welcome to a bonus edition of TV Guidance Counselor. I don't know why I've gone full radio here, or that's more like baseball, I think. I've heard of baseball. Anyway, welcome to a bonus edition of TV Guidance Counselor. I am Ken Reed, your TV Guidance Counselor, the on-hiatus stand-up comedian who's been doing this show since February 14th, 2014. Each and every week, someone comes on the show virtually for the last year and picks a TV guide from my personal collection. I scan it, send them a PDF, they go through and pick what they'd watch that week in history, and we discuss their choices. That is the show. This week, I had a chance to talk to two amazing people. If you heard my Dom Jolly episode earlier in the week, that was super fun. If you didn't, go back and listen to that. You don't have to right now. You can listen to this first. It's not serialized, everybody. You can listen in any order. But I also had an opportunity to talk to Mike Mignola, who you may know as the creator of Hellboy, among other things. Amazing artist, great comic book artist, great just artist generally, and writer. And I've wanted to talk to him for a really long time. This was so fun. I was so glad that I had the opportunity to chat with him. So you get the opportunity to hear two episodes this week. You're welcome. If there are other people you'd like me to try to get on the show, you can email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or ken@ikenread.com, or I'm on social media at TV Guidance or at Kenneth, KennethWRead. That's Kenneth W. Reed. You can send me a message there. You can go on our Patreon. You can go, just Google. Yeah. I mean, I'm not endorsed by Google, but I think I can say Google. I don't think I'm going to be in trouble with Big Bing, if that's still a thing. Anyway, you'll enjoy this. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy this bonus episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Mike Mignola.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Mike Mignola, how are you, sir?
I'm fine. How are you?
I'm doing well. You had said to me before we started recording, this is the most homework you've ever done for an interview.
Yeah. Because usually my interviews are about me, so I can do that off the top of my head. But I did need a bit of a refresher on what I was watching on TV.
Yeah, and it's funny because it ends up being, or at least in most cases, more about you than you thought it might be once you start taking a look at what you were watching as a kid. I don't know if that was the case.
Well, I remember, when I think about what I watched as a kid, there are only three or four shows that pop up, but, I mean, there's separate categories. There's the stuff I remember watching endlessly that left no impression. How many millions of episodes of Flipper and Gilligan's Island and shit like that. Though Gilligan's Island did scar me in an interesting way. But then there are those couple moments from other shows that have haunted me through my whole life. The things you caught just a little tiny bit of. And they all seem to be concentrated in that like 1970s area.
Yeah, it's funny too, because especially in that 1970s era, to your point, you would catch these things. You didn't necessarily know what the hell you were seeing. And it was really hard to go back and figure out what it was. And there were so many shows that this sounds ridiculous when I explain it to kids, people younger than us, where you would go to school and tell other people what you saw and you'd sound like a lunatic.
Or there's the thing where you all saw that same movie. So you would just like, did you see that thing? Yeah. What the fuck was that thing? and everybody would be talking about it. And not just for that next day, but there were some shows you talked about. It seemed like, for months. I remember because I was in Boy Scouts and you would go backpacking for a week. So we had no TV, but we would just talk endlessly over that one TV movie we had seen that year.
Do you remember what it was?
No.
Because that was...
The one movie that springs to mind that, for years you would say, do you remember this show? I mean, I'm sure we talked about it at the time, but even years later, we would talk about, do you remember this movie? About this downed B-52 bomber in the desert, and it turns out the crew is all ghosts.
Yes.
And, you know, people would go, maybe, kind of. And then little by little, you found the people that remembered it. And then just recently, there's a good DVD copy out there, and I rewatched it. And it's one of those crazy things where I rewatched it, and it was almost exactly the way I remembered it.
Yeah.
I had rewritten the very beginning of it. So actually, it was a little bit better the way I had rewritten
of
the
course.
Beginning. But for the most part, the whole time you're watching it, you're going, yep. And the most chilling moment was exactly the way I remembered it. It was so stamped on there.
It's so weird because when we watched these things growing up, when the idea of having a VCR wasn't even, I don't even think sci-fi had gotten that yet.
Oh, no.
And so when you watch these, yeah, you made sure that you wide-eyed recorded every second in your brain because you're like, I will never see this again.
Well, the same thing with when a movie was in the theater. If you didn't see the movie in the theater, you knew you had to wait at least a year for it to be on TV, but they would cut out the good parts.
Yes.
And then once it was on TV, you also never knew if you would ever see it again, which is why, and again, trying to explain this to young people, where you go, oh no, when the TV guide would come, you would scan through there looking for movies. And if it was on at 2:30 in the morning, you set your alarm to get up because you didn't know if Frankenstein versus the Wolfman would ever be shown again.
Right. You couldn't rent it. You might be able to get one of those Castle 8mm things of it with no sound, and it's like 5 minutes of the movie, but that was about as good as you do.
But I also think it made a huge impression on my generation, especially of people who do what I do,
right?
Because we were so starved for these movies, and you were so at the mercy of when they would be shown that you just sucked them up because, you didn't know if you'd ever see it again. And you know, now, and I always say, you know, there were only like half a dozen monster movies, right. You know, when I was a kid, and you endlessly search for them, where now you can't turn on the TV without stumbling across whole networks devoted to vampire movies,
right.
Or everything is at your fingertips because of DVD and everything else. But back then, I think we were so starved for this stuff that it made such a huge impression. And yeah, there's something about watching something and thinking, I will never get the chance to see it again. So I'm going to, yeah, like I said, suck it up. It's not just like one of those things you go, oh yeah, I'll watch it again later. It's like, no, this is the one and only time I have to see this.
If I miss it now, because you're sort of at the very tail end of that monster kid generation where that shock theater package of the Universal movies had kind of gone in the 50s. So it predated you a little bit, but you were still sort of young enough to fall in love with that sort of mid to late 60s monster craze of like Addams Family Munsters and that sort of fun stuff, but where it was a little bit more sanitized.
Yeah. I mean, I always, you know, like one of the big questions I always get is, well, where does this love of monsters and stuff come from? And I can't pin it down. And to me, I know what book did it. You know, Dracula when I was like 13 years old, which is, again, right around the time we're talking about. Mm-hmm. But there had to be something earlier. And I remember, you know, as a kid checking out of the library a book on ghosts and a book on Norse mythology. But it's like, yeah, but what was – there had to be something. I got to think it came from TV. There had to be something I saw early on that made me go, ooh, monsters, that works for me. And was it the Munsters or was it –
Outer Limits, maybe. I'm trying to think of early to mid-60s.
But you know what? Because the way our TV was, we got all the standard channels. And then there was UHF?
Yep.
There was that other dial that didn't work in our house.
Right.
Except maybe you'd get just static. But that's where the Addams Family was. That's where Twilight Zone was. That's where Outer Limits were, which I heard people talking about for years, but I'd never seen any of that stuff.
Wow.
So we got the Munsters. We got that basically the lowbrow version of everything, you know, in our house. We didn't get the Marx Brothers, though they were there. But we watched, you know, the Three Stooges.
Right.
The Three Stooges and Abbott and Costello we got. And years later, like in art school, people are saying to me, wait, you've never seen the Marx Brothers? And you've never seen the Addams Family? It's like, no, you know, the Munsters. That's what we got.
Yeah, but I mean, as a kid, like the Munsters looked better and the Addams Family was a better show.
it's funny because I went back and looked at the Munsters recently, and I think maybe the you know the first episode, and it really looks like a Universal monster movie.
Yeah,
I mean it's got, and I think they cleaned it up as the show went on. But early on, at least the thing I'm remembering, and this is from not too many years ago, it seems that the like Eddie Munster was sitting inside the fireplace, and everything was draped in cobwebs and stuff, and it really looked like one of those Universal monster movies. Because even the like B Universal movies or the shows, like you look at something like Thriller, which again I'd never seen as a kid, but you know if it was Universal, they did it up,
and they
used cobwebs and shit, and the Munsters really had that feel.
Yeah, and in the pilot of the Munsters, Butch Patrick doesn't play Eddie Munster. They have another kid, and the version of Eddie is like really monstrous. He's terrifyingly scary, and they kind of made him a little more kid friendly when they recast him. But there's stills of it in footage you can find on YouTube now, and it's like a ferocious werewolf child.
Wow.
And it's really scary. I remember seeing stills of that in one of those books they had from the 70s that were like monster movies, like the most generic titles. And, you know, all the info would be wrong in them, but you'd see pictures you never saw anywhere else.
Well, and those were the books that we, you know, because because I didn't see a lot of the horror movies, the good horror movies when I was a kid. But we would go into Berkeley, because I grew up in Oakland, we'd go into Berkeley, and we'd buy all those books about horror movies. And they were like checklists. You know, it was like, oh my God, I've never heard of any of these movies. Someday they'll be on TV. You know, because again, you still couldn't dream of DVD, you know, DVD and videotape. But someday these things will be on TV. I got to keep an eye out for this thing and this thing and this thing. And, you know, I never saw any of the good Hammer films. So for years, I just imagined how great these mythological films must have been. And, you know, so everyone I finally saw was almost all of them were just a crashing disappointment because I'd built up in my head how amazing these things were. Because the ones we saw all the time as a kid, even of the Universal Pictures, it just seemed like the one that was always on Saturday was Dracula, which is maybe the dullest one.
Oh, it's so boring. And it's funny. Yeah. Once I saw the Spanish Dracula, that one they did on the same sets, I was like, oh, this could have been a much better movie, original Dracula.
Yeah. Well, and I probably saw Frankenstein, but even though it's one of my favorite movies now, as a kid, I never saw Bride of Frankenstein. How did I miss it? It must have been on TV occasionally, but I remember I was in my late teens when I finally saw Bride of Frankenstein, and I just remember just my jaw hanging open going, oh my God.
Yeah.
Frankenstein and Bride of Frankenstein, there's a billion years difference between these two movies.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Bride of Frankenstein always strikes me as a movie where someone's like, hey, I'm probably going to get fired, so let's just go for it.
You know what? I think of it like those first two Tim Burton movies. The first movie is like, I will give you a studio movie. That made money. Now leave me alone to do what I want.
Right.
And that's so much what Bride of Frankenstein seems to be. It's like, make a sequel. We don't care what it is. And Whale went, okay, I'm gonna play now.
You guys just don't care. It's fine. I can just, okay, I'll see you guys in 6 months.
Yeah.
That's kind of thing. When did you finally see those Hammer movies? Do you remember how old you were?
God, most of them I don't think I even saw until I was watching them on DVD.
Wow.
Because I just don't remember them being on TV.
They rarely were. We would get some on some of our really high on the UHF dial stations here because they were like extra cheap, the Hammer movies. Weirdly, because, you know, they look so good.
I have to take it back, though. I did. There was one I saw because for us, as you know, in my early years, in Oakland, California, we had Creature Features. Mm-hmm. That was our Saturday night, late night monster show. So they must have owned a copy of was it The Evil of Frankenstein.
Oh, nice.
And that thing scared me to death. Well, that's maybe exaggerating, but it made such a huge impression. Kiwi Kingston as sort of their version of the Karloff monster. Mm-hmm. I find all Hammer people hate that one, but to me, I loved it. The monster was so disturbing. That one I saw over and over, and then there was another Peter Cushing one with these glob things that suck the bones out of people.
Oh. But,
Island of Terror?
Yes. That is an obscure one, too.
Yeah, those were the two that were exotic because they were British.
Right. A little bit classy, a little exotic. Because when you mentioned that you hadn't really seen those two in depth, and it shocked me that it was in the DVD era, because one of the first things I remember seeing of your work was the Dracula adaptation. And I feel like that is... I mean, it's its own thing, but it also incorporated, in my mind, a lot of the great visuals from the Hammer movies without the kind of boring stuff from the Hammer movies. Mm. So was that something that you picked up just from the script or from working on?
No, I mean, again, I think I was just really dealing with what that movie was. I don't think I was trying to do anything else. I certainly didn't consciously bring anything else into it. Yeah, I don't know.
I mean, maybe that's why it's such a sort of a novel take too, because you're almost not, in some ways it might be easier to adapt a piece of work like that when you haven't been inundated with every other version of it on Earth.
Yeah, I mean, the beauty of that adaptation was Coppola and his people were really forthcoming with material. So I was given access to basically just, I would go up there to Zoetrope in San Francisco, and there were just bales, I mean, big folders full of photo reference. And they would just basically say, take whatever you want. Write down the numbers of everything that you see, and we will make up prints for you and send them to you.
That is very forthcoming, because I remember talking to, I think it was Rick Veitch maybe, or Steve Bissett, who worked on 1941 adaptation or one of the Star Wars ones, and they got nothing. It was like, well, do this adaptation, you don't get it, just make it up, but make it look like the movie that we're not showing you.
I mean, yeah, I remember, like, I think it was Walt Simonson talking about either 2001 or may have even been Alien. Though Alien, he must have had a reference.
Yeah,
I think it was like 2001, or not 2001, what's the Spielberg?
Close Encounters?
Close Encounters. That it was like, we're going to show you this movie. No, put your sketchbook away. We're going to show it to you, and that's it. And then you got to go draw it. So, you know, I hope your memory is good. And maybe they didn't even show them the movie. Maybe it was like, yeah, here's a dozen pictures. And we'll just, yeah, I've never seen the adaptation, so I don't know what he ended up drawing.
Flashcards.
But yeah, that certainly wasn't my experience. I mean, they basically gave me everything I wanted.
But that reminds me of something in a funny way, that it's almost like that your generation of artists trained for that in some way, in that if you love these movies and you couldn't see them all the time, everyone I know who went into the creative arts either made their own movies, like little 8mm, in an attempt to make something to watch, or became an artist and would constantly draw things from these movies just to have something to look at.
Yeah, you know, the thing is, I think my thing was I became a book hoarder. You know, so it was like scrapbooking these movies. I couldn't see the movie, but I could have all the different books about vampire movies and horror movies. So I could have that catalog of all that visual stuff. Because I don't really remember drawing stuff from the movies. I don't remember drawing monster movies or monster, you know, characters. I don't remember drawing Frankenstein as a kid. I don't remember any of that. So I think I'm a little out of step with a lot of those kind of guys.
Right.
But it made a huge impression, but it led me more towards hoarding the images and it led me to the books. It made me a horror reader.
That's interesting. So growing up here in New England, because the other thing I was going to mention is your point, you grew up in Oakland, and I'm always surprised every time I'm reminded that you're a California guy, because your work has this such, to me, has this sort of New England-y Northeast feel. And obviously spending a lot of time in Providence as a kid, I used to find Lovecraft stuff everywhere, which was sort of pre-reanimate. Like, people didn't even really care too much about him. And so it's funny how I never equate you with California.
Well, yeah, because California, what do people equate with California? I don't draw palm trees.
Right.
I draw creepy things because horror stuff is England and it's New England and that kind of stuff. So visually, that's what's inside my head, not, you know, California sunshine and,
right,
you know, surfing.
Right. So when you were getting these books and sort of collecting this library, that time that you were probably also doing this was also that time when America sort of post-hippie became a little bit obsessed with supernatural, ESP, In Search Of, that sort of stuff. And I imagine that sort of became a little bit of an interest too, just given your work later?
Not really.
Oh, wow.
I remember when the UFO stuff got really big. But again, I don't remember that, and because I know there was TV stuff, but I only remember the books. And the way I have two brothers, the way we divided up books, everybody kind of picked a separate category. Huh. So one of my middle brother, Scott, he, for whatever reason, was the Chariots of the God, Bermuda Triangle. He read all that stuff. That wasn't really me. And again, I never really had that much interest in, well, I shouldn't say this. I would say I don't have any interest in the true stuff, right, though. Ghosts, true ghost stuff, I've always loved. And I say true with the quotation mark around it. But the one thing I do remember on TV, and I don't know when this was, but it made a huge impact, was there was, and I don't know where it was, somewhere there was a haunted Toys R Us.
Oh, wow. I've never heard of this.
And there was this thing on TV where they had a medium and a film crew in the aisle of this haunted Toys R Us in the middle of the night. It might not have been a Toys R Us. I'm not sure what it was, but I think it was some kind of toy store. It was certainly a store of some kind.
Right, right.
And they're in the aisle, and the medium sees the ghost and is talking very patiently to the ghost. And of course, you can't see the ghost, but there was something so disturbing about this. I think it was a woman speaking in this very patient way to this figure you couldn't see. And she's, I remember saying, he says we're sitting in the water, because apparently there used to be a stream there or something, you know. I can kind of half still see it in my head, and I can certainly hear the tone of voice as she's trying to explain to this spirit that, no, we're actually not sitting in the water.
Wow. I mean, that's like the ultimate kid terror, in that, to your point earlier, where horror is sort of England, New England, and that sort of stuff. When you put that in a place of joy, or sort of a modern place that a kid especially would be very familiar with, there's something really terrifying about that.
Well, and sad is something I've always related to. There was something so sad about it, that you're trying to patiently explain to this spirit, no, you know, you're just confused. You know,
right,
you're in a toy store now.
Right.
Yeah, it's funny how many of these things just left this little teaser in my head, these couple little moments. There's even a moment in one of the Batman shows that, and again, I remember watching Batman. I can kind of see it. Didn't make a gigantic impression, except, and maybe I'm completely wrong, maybe I've invented this scene entirely, but I remember a bit where, for some reason, Catwoman she's about to fall into some bottomless pit. and Batman is holding her, and she, and then they have this like sad exchange, like it's like, if you just give up, I can pull you out of this hole, and she won't give up, and he drops her. And again, maybe I've rewritten this over the years, but I remember that being such a sad, emotional thing, which is not something you usually associate with the old Batman TV show, right?
No. These
like sad, emotional right. moments. But I think I've turned whatever I actually saw into this heart-rending moment.
Were you that kind of kid anyway? Like a really empathetic sort of, dramatic's not the right word, but like sort of imbuing things with emotion kind of kid?
I think I always responded to that stuff in a real strong way, which is weird that so much of when I go through the TV guide, so much of what I watched was just like crappy comedy stuff. but it's those kind of like tear-jerkery kind of moments that a lot of those kind of things stuck out. Even, you know, I mentioned Soul Survivor, which I think came out in 70. So I had to be 10 years old.
Yeah.
So that's pretty early for that thing to and I just saw it the once until, you know, just recently. I just saw it the once as a kid because I don't think they aired it again. But there's a bit at the end where they've found a guy's body and they're putting him in a body bag, and he's describing in horrifying, like panicky detail that they're putting this flag over his body. So because as they would find these bodies and they would bag them up, the ghosts would disappear.
Huh.
And I remember word for word what he was saying in his panicky thing. So it wasn't really scary as much as it was super sad and emotional. So those are the things that really, you know, left a mark.
Right. As they, in theory, as they should, the things with an emotional anchor are the things that should stick with you. But it's something I weirdly don't hear as often, which is kind of funny because when you say it, it makes perfect sense. course.
It's funny because, you know, that's also one of the ones that are, you know, Channel 2, our local station, they must have owned a copy of Moby Dick because that John Huston Moby Dick movie, because it's the drama of it, you know, those dramatic moments that made such a gigantic impact. Whereas I know a lot of guys are super affected by the visuals of the monster stuff, but for me, it's always been those dramatic moments, unless we talk about Dark Shadows. And again, I think because Dark Shadows was forbidden territory.
Right.
That was, for whatever reason, I never saw it or saw so little of it that I had this craving for it. I would spend most summers, I think, because my mother had died when I was really young. My brothers and I were sent off to live with my aunt over the summers. And my cousin was a little bit older than us, so he was allowed to watch Dark Shadows. So my earliest memories of Dark Shadows is sitting outside the room where he was watching Dark Shadows and listening to Dark Shadows.
Interesting.
So I didn't see it. And then I remember being at somebody else's house and seeing just, it was on, and it was one of those rare moments where there's actually a monster, and it, like a guy turns into a werewolf and somebody stabs him with a pair of scissors. Again, I've tried rewatching Dark Shadows looking for that scene. And there's another bit that made a gigantic impression. Again, I must have just walked into a room when this scene was on, and there was a head inside a glass box.
Mm-hmm. I know the scene you're discussing.
And that thing, and I think there's another scene where somebody's burning a hand and like throws a hand in a fireplace. You know, those couple little bits. Maybe I saw more of it, but it was just those couple things where I was like, oh my God, what am I looking at? And they made this stamp in my head.
Yeah, because you weren't supposed to see it.
Right. And certainly you never expect to see a head in a box with its eyes opening. But I know where. I've got all the DVDs. I know where the storyline with the head in a box is. And one of these days I will rewatch it and see just how terrible it is. But I also, one of those things, and And it's one of those things I've never really compared notes with anybody about Dark Shadows, because I don't really find that many people who give a shit about Dark Shadows.
Right.
But I remember coming home from school, and I looked it up in the TV guide. It was on at 4 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
So it makes sense that it would have been on just as I came home from school. And at one point we had a, because we had housekeepers, and must have had one of those housekeepers who was actually watching Dark Shadows. Because I remember coming home, it's the only time only memory I have of watching Dark Shadows in my own house. Coming home, and it may have been, it seemed like it was the very last episode.
It very well could have, time-wise.
Yeah, because there's some kind of curse, and if you spend the night in this special room, you break the curse, and and that's what I remember seeing, is that, oh, you've spent the night, and the ghost shows up and says basically the curse is all lifted, and everything's going to be great now. And then at the very end, there's a scream, and somebody outside has been attacked by a wolf. it was this weird kind of, the show is over. Oh, except if we get renewed, somebody just got mauled in the front yard.
We want to give ourselves a little something to latch on to.
Yeah, just in case they demand it. They're shutting us down, but let's see if they're really going to shut us down.
Right.
And again, I've got them on DVDs. All I have to do is pull out the last DVD and see if that jibes with my memory at all, which maybe I will do one of these days.
It's a weird thing to do that, though, because to Soul Survivor, pleasantly surprised that it holds up. Other things, and Dark Shadows may be one of them, in that show is more soap than scary. And so with all the limitations of soaps.
I did start a few years ago when I got the DVDs. I did say I'm going to go through the whole thing, and it's rough.
Yeah.
But it's so funny because there are certain episodes that are packed with stuff. It's almost like it's sweeps week. So Barnabas goes crazy. He kills six people and he walls a priest up in the wall.
Right.
And then nothing happens for the next, 18 episodes. It's fine for background noise, even though as background noise, it starts to drive you crazy after a while.
Yeah.
But I was thinking, I'm going to watch the whole thing. Well, I maybe got through a quarter of it, which is pretty darn good. And one of these days I'll pick it up where I left off and
well, there's hundreds of episodes.
Some more.
Yeah, I mean,
there's a lot.
People are like, "Oh yeah, no, I marathon Dark Shadows. That's why you haven't seen me in 4 weeks."
But it's, like those early ones where they're first finding Barnabas Collins and stuff. And they're really, it's very cheaply done, but it's so much. Maybe that's where my love of this stuff came from. Just that idea of a vampire chained in a coffin. Even if I only knew about it from other kids talking about it, it might have been enough that when I read Dracula, I was like, yep, this is it. This is the stuff. Because talk about that New England thing. It's that foggy, that opening music to Dark Shadows and the Big Mansion and all that stuff. That's so much the world that's inside my head.
It's interesting too, because when there are a few movies that were shot in the sort of the Bay Area that I think are set in New England, one of them being John Carpenter's The Fog, and the other one being a movie called Dead and Buried that Dan O'Bannon did. I don't know if you've seen either one of those.
The Fog, yeah.
Yeah, The Fog. But it's funny that they've used basically where you grew up to represent what the place in your head when I think about them now.
Yeah, that is funny. Yeah.
So weirdly, even having grown up here, when I think of that sort of stuff, I think of The Fog and Dead and Buried.
That's funny. There was another one. There's another one that haunted me as a kid. Well, there's a couple other ones that haunted me as a kid. One I'd really love to get on DVD. you know, maybe somebody can send me a bootleg someday.
Oh, yeah. A listener may have one. If
The Vulture.
I have not
Do you
seen
know
it.
This one?
No.
It's one that, you know, Creature Features would show every other week. And I just remember, and apparently it's about a guy who's like half vulture.
Huh.
I think it's British. But I just remember a woman gets off a bus and walks through a cemetery, and as she goes through the cemetery, a tombstone starts to wiggle back and forth, and something, I think it flies out of the grave, but you just see the shadow passing over her head, and then I think later she's either dead of a heart attack or her hair's turned white, I don't remember, and then I remember something about cliff and dead sheep. You know, the rest of it's kind of a blur, but that opening bit made such a gigantic impression. And you would think, if I saw the whole movie, there has to be a visual of a guy who's half man, half vulture. For some reason, that's completely missing from my memory. Maybe it was so terrible looking that I just... or maybe I was so scared that I never saw that part. I don't know.
I have good news for you.
Yeah.
The Vulture, 1966. It was produced in Canada, but shot in Cornwall in the UK. And currently, the entire film is on YouTube.
Oh.
Which is a new phenomenon. In the last, like, year, for some reason, all these sort of lost TV movies and, like, never picked up pilots, people have just been dumping them on YouTube. And I keep... And at first, I would, like, watch them right away because I'm like, this is going to go away real soon. But they're not touching them. It's really weird.
Well, I've had a real hard time watching anything of any length. Considering how much time I can spend on the computer, I've had a hard time watching anything of any length on the computer. I've always been a DVD guy. You know, I like, because if I want to see something, on the off chance I like it, I need to own it.
Yeah.
There's definitely a hoarder mentality to me that's like, yes, yes, that seems like something not only that I need to see, but I need to have that. but I will, yes, I will have to, you know, watch this one.
Speaking of the right guy there.
Yeah. I'm trying to think of another one that's like that. Oh, again, one, I remember being at my aunt's house and catching this very odd thing that scarred me for years. And I remember talking to Stephen King about it. Because he had written that book about, didn't he write a book about horror films?
Dance Macabre, yeah. It's one of my favorite books. I always recommend that book to people who are trying to write comedy because I'm like, look, the structure's exactly the same. This explains it really well.
But I remember describing this one scene that was burned into my memory, and he was like, no, sorry, I have no fucking idea what that is.
He doesn't
know. Somebody is sleeping in bed, and this, it's like a ventriloquist dummy, I think with a long knitting needle, is walking around the foot of the bed.
And it's not dead of night? Is it black and white?
No, it's not dead of night. It's black and white. The more I thought about it, because I think also in the same movie, the devil shows up. And so which made me think, it's probably Mexican.
Yeah.
And of course, Del Toro, of all people, Del Toro knew what it was.
Of course.
And I can't remember now what it's called. I want to say Attack of the Puppet People.
Oh,
it might be that.
Yeah, because K. Gordon Murray re-edited all those for U.S. Yes, it must be Attack of the Puppet People. That makes sense.
Yeah.
Those Mexican movies. I bet you got more of those being in California than we did here.
Maybe. But that's the only, I don't remember ever consciously watching that stuff. It was just one of those things, like, I walked into a room and somebody else was watching this, and I was just like, what is that?
Why would you do this?
Yeah, oh my God. And that's the one, I think that was the only one that I didn't know what it was. That's the only thing I can think of where I had no idea what it was, and I would ask people for years, what is this? Do you know? And people are like, no, I have no idea what that is.
I love that you went to the two people who might know in the world. One of them didn't, and one of them did.
It's weird because I did. I must have talked to Stephen King for a total of about 5 minutes once, and that's the only thing I remember talking to him about. Is, you know, it's like, how is it? I just said, hey, you're Stephen King. Maybe you could solve this problem.
It's my one chance.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's I vaguely remember that movie airing, but I don't recall seeing it. We did you grow up Catholic?
Yeah.
I think so. I mean, here in New England, I think everybody is sort of culturally Catholic, even if we didn't grow up that way. But weirdly, there was a UHF channel that showed Spanish language movies, and they would show all the El Santo movies.
Mm.
And it hit me how Catholic a lot of that stuff is, which makes sense,
yeah.
But then also mixed with weird Aztec stuff.
Yeah. And there's so many of these things I wish I had seen as a kid, you know, because I can only imagine the impact that stuff would have made. But yeah, never saw any of the wrestler stuff. So never saw the Aztec mummy stuff. And it's just not the same watching it now. It's fantastic. And it's funny, I've used so many of those kind of things in my work,
right,
but entirely based on a picture I've seen in a book and my idea of how cool it must have been. So I'm not hamstrung by how terrible these things were. I've just made them into the greatest things ever inside my head.
That's almost it isn't almost better. It is better as having them almost like springboards or like, hey, tell us a story about this.
Well, it's like, you know, I've seen people do super faithful, you know, like stories about like The Shadow,
right,
or Doc Savage. And you go, yeah, that's fine. You've made it as dull as the original.
Right.
But to consume that stuff when you're 12 or 13, which is when I consumed that shit, and then you mix it with leftover Jack Kirby stuff from the Fantastic Four and everything else in your brain, and you chew it over and chew it over and chew it over, and you spit it out as something else, then you've supercharged it, you've mixed it with other stuff, and you've just, you've coughed up something that's as great as you remember it being when you were 12.
Yeah, I mean, I always equate it with, I do not enjoy the band Kiss, but as a kid, I would just see pictures of Kiss, and I loved horror movies, and I'm like, this band's probably fucking awesome.
Yeah.
And then I heard them, and I'm like, oh, this is like lame disco. Just like, this
now,
is
see,
not what
I was, at that age where not only did I love the visuals, but that was my favorite band.
Yeah.
Yeah,
Kiss meets Phantom of the Park.
That I did not. I probably saw it. Didn't. I think I was past it by then.
The only Marvel comic with actual blood in the ink.
I do remember that. I do remember that.
What a gimmick.
Oh God! And that was. You think about it. Kiss might have been my second favorite band after the Partridge Family. Again, the 70s, and I was probably 11, 12 years old. Gigantic crush on Susan Day.
Yeah. I mean, that was the law back then.
I think I was just at that age where it was just like, I was looking for something, and it was like between her and, again, I don't know what year it was, Jenny Agutter in
Logan's Run. Yep. 73, I think. So yeah, it would have been around the same. Oh, yeah. Jenny Agutter in Logan's Run. So many people.
That made an impression.
The Kirby thing, and I say this to so many people, because obviously I assume you're a big comics reader at this time.
Yeah, I was.
Kirby, and I say this to people all the time, I'm like, oh, you know everything we have in popular culture now? Kirby. Like, Kirby in 1970. Oh, String Theory? Pretty much Kirby. Like, it's like a very weird thing about how much he's influenced, I think, a lot of the popular culture people have now, but like three steps removed.
Yeah, it's funny because I wasn't a DC guy. I was only a Marvel Comics guy. I didn't see a lot of the weirdest of the Kirby stuff.
You still saw Devil Dinosaur.
No, I didn't, because that was Jack coming back to Marvel. And
right.
Around that time, I was getting out of comics.
Right.
So I do remember the 2001 stuff, which I liked. And around the same day, did the Eternals, which I really liked, which also tapped into that whole, you know, Chariots of the Gods stuff. That was very cool. But by then, I was pretty much sliding away from comics. And some of the stuff Jack did was just really wonky stuff.
Oh, yes.
when he came back to Captain America, it was really, there was some very disturbing stuff he did, but also some pretty goofy stuff. So yeah, I was on my way out. So it was the early, when he was doing Fantastic Four, when he was doing Thor, that was the stuff that really, put the hook in me.
So you're kind of the first generation of people who grew up with comic books and television who started making stuff. And I always find that fascinating for the very reason that you just said. You're sort of cherry picking the best of those things inadvertently or on purpose.
What struck me struck me about comics, and especially about Marvel comics, is when I started reading that stuff, when I get seriously into comics, Marvel comics, the Jack Kirby, Stan Lee stuff, the superhero stuff, had only been around for about 10 years.
Which is crazy.
Because it was such a gigantic world that had its roots back in the Western characters and all this other stuff. And you just felt like it was something that had been there forever. And at some point, I'm like, I'm 25 years into Hellboy, By the time I was 25 years into Marvel Comics, I had lost interest. Granted, it was a much bigger world with a million more people working on it, so it made it a much bigger thing. But, in 1970, it felt like it had been around forever.
Yeah, I mean, where you're at Hellboy now chronologically is like 1986 for Marvel.
Yeah,
which is kind of insane.
Nobody remembers,
right?
for good reasons.
Yes, yeah, it's very weird. I think that the stuff that happened in the first part and to the mid-century of the 20th century, it seemed like each year was a decade, and I think that's from the innovation or just because so much stuff was new, maybe.
Well, yeah, I mean, if you think about what this way, when people talk about Kirby, it's easy to say nobody will ever do what he did because between him and Steve Ditko, but Ditko, I think, to a much lesser extent, Kirby was inventing shit with Stan, but inventing new shit every 10 minutes.
Yes.
So that there's this explosion of those first however many 10 years, whatever it is, and then everything since then, 90% of everything since then is feeding off of what was created in this explosion.
Yeah. And that's sort of true of a lot of pop culture I've found, where in some ways I feel like we're in this post-apocalyptic sort of, we can only make stuff out of things we already have world. It's almost like Mad Max pop culture.
Well, yeah, I mean, I've heard that very cynical thing of every story has been told and, reinvention is the only thing that can be done now. I had an argument with somebody once who was saying that basically Neil Adams had invented Batman. And I was trying to explain. It's like, well, no, because he didn't.
Right.
Because there was a Batman. He goes, yeah, but Neil reinvented it so completely, it was basically invented. I'm like, no, because there was a time where there wasn't anything called Batman.
Yes.
And then the next day, there was something called Batman.
Yes.
So we can say this guy invented it. He was an asshole,
yes,
by all accounts, but he is the guy who created Batman.
Right.
Because there was Zorro, and there was this. It's like, yeah.
But that wasn't
Zorro
Batman.
Zorro wasn't Batman. Somebody had to put that shit together.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, it's hard. I guess the way I would say it that's somewhat less cynical is that it's harder and harder to do that in a way that innovates.
Yeah.
Just because there's so much stuff.
Yeah, there and everybody, I mean, God, I can't tell you how many of these like meetings I've been in where people are like, well, we can't do vampires because vampires have been done. We can't do this because it's been done. It's like, it's been done. When was the last time it was done well? But there's that sense of, oh, it's all been done. Well, then what do you want? Well, we want something different. Well, you give them something different, and then they go, this is great. We love this because it's never been seen before. And then by the end of that meeting, they're starting to turn it into something that they've seen before.
Oh, totally.
It's like, we want something original, but we don't know what to do with it if it shows up.
Yeah.
Which is why it's always frustrating to me when you see a movie advertised as a comedy. And because it's not really a comedy, but they didn't know what else to call it. So they cut a trailer that made it look like a comedy. So then when you go see it, if you go see it, you go, that was a really cool movie. Why did they try to sell it as a comedy? Because somebody's job it is to sell these things, and nobody can put something out there saying, this is a movie unlike anything you've ever seen before.
Yeah, people need to, especially non-creative people and executives. I mean, I've been in pitches where they're said, you know, this is our favorite show on our channel. Do you have a show like that? And I'll pull something out of my ass and they'll go, we love that. Write it up. And I'll bring it in. And then they'll go, this is too much like that show we told you to make something like. It's like goes both ways where you're like, what do you do? So you want something new that you've seen before.
Well, I think there's always that guy in the room who's trying to do the math. You know, this plus this equals success. And comics, like anything else, has gone through that. You know, you'd heard stories about an editor who will say, or editor-in-chief who will say, green covers. We've done the math. Green covers sell.
Yeah.
Now it's just, if it's a good thing and nobody knows, if you start talking about, but this is good and this is bad, then you run into people going, I don't know what you mean.
Right.
I remember, again, one of those early conversations I had with some kind of studio executive guy, and he mentioned some movie, and I said, yeah, but it's a terrible movie. And he looked at me blank faced and said, it made X amount of money. And he wasn't even joking.
Yep.
He was like, it made this much money. What do you mean it's a bad movie?
Yeah.
And I just remember the blood draining out of my face and looking at this guy going, oh my God, I have absolutely no frame of reference to talk to this guy, because if it made money, he literally doesn't understand how you could say it was a bad movie.
Right, right. And it's like, but look, guys, the thing is, the things that appeal to the most people tend to be the most mediocre. Like, that's just how things work. So you're using the inverse of quality to dictate what's good.
So the beauty is, and having worked in Hollywood a little bit, when I now see something that's really interesting, I'm just all the more amazed that it made it,
mm-hmm.
that it exists. And again, especially even, you know, with old movies, you look at old movies, you go, oh my God, there was a time where it was possible for this thing to have been made. How lucky are we that these rare gems exist,
yep.
Or occasionally they still manage to get made? Because especially with this new stuff, I know how many people were in that meeting trying to make this thing not exist.
Yes, yes.
Whereas I think the beauty of the old stuff is, it was like, well, can you make it for a dollar?
Right.
You can? Fine. Bride of Frankenstein, we don't care. Just bring it in 8 weeks or whatever it was, and that's fine.
Yeah,
the kids, it's got the monster, it's got the Frankenstein running around. That's what the kids like. That's fine.
You're the expert here. You make the monster. Here's the money. Just do it. I don't know. You do it.
See, there's a scene where he's sort of crucified, and there's this whole Catholic thing, and they're like, fine, you got the but you got the monster killing a guy, right?
Yeah.
So that's fine.
But there's a whole gay subtext. Whatever. Is there fire? Fine.
Well, the thing to me, the killer to me in Bride of Frankenstein is, and it was one of the things that made my brain explode. Again, the emotional stuff, the sadness with the old man, mm-hmm. the old blind man,
oh, yes.
And he's tucked Frankenstein away in bed, and he's put, and Frankenstein, like, has a little tear come out of his eye, which
yeah.
is fantastic. And then the screen goes black, except for the crucifix on the wall behind him.
Yeah.
And it's just, it's like when you see the demon face in The Exorcist. It's not there for long, but it's there long enough that you go, whoa, what the fuck was that?
Right. Someone walked over my grave.
Yeah, just one of my favorite things in a movie, because you just go, it's not even, it's like somebody purposely said, and then we'll just have the crucifix there on the wall for a bit.
Yeah, it's those things that, this is a weird analogy, but a friend of mine who was a TV writer forever said they used to call moments like that, tuna sandwich moments. And what they meant was, in the old Mary Tyler Moore show, like, the plot would be going on, but Mary, you know, Rhoda would come in and Mary would go, you want a tuna fish sandwich? And she'd be like, oh, I don't know. Oh, I'll make you one. And then they move on to the plot. It's something that has nothing to do with moving things along, but adds all this color and little moments into something that makes it so much better. And, you know, she was saying in the context of now that a TV show's 20 minutes, you have no room for any of those moments. But they do have this massive effect, like one shot or one image.
Yeah, it's when characters get to have a conversation that doesn't move the plot.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's recently I've been reading like spy, in that spy fiction, but like crime fiction, and I start looking for, oh, that seemed like a comment that was so weird and not part of the story. But I got to flag it mentally because maybe that's the thing that we're going to come back to. And I always love when you don't come back to those things. Just are going to talk about this weird thing for a minute.
Yeah.
It's the same thing in movies or TV, just having those moments that are just amazing, but you know, they didn't come from a studio note saying, you got to explain this. They're also the first things that get edited out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, totally. Were you ever a fan of Jim Thompson's books?
Jim Thompson. No, I've never read them, but I know about them.
I was a big sort of pulp fiction, sort of crime novel reader, but like old stuff, Dashiell Hammond, and you know the noir-y stuff.
Stuff I've just started reading.
Yes, and I sort of graduated from that into Jim Thompson, thinking it would be the same. And his books are basically only just the stuff that has nothing to do with plot, like The Killer Inside Me. There, so many of them are first person books,
which I just bought on Amazon.
Oh man, it's one of my favorites.
Well, I got that with Joe Lansdale because again, it's all color.
Yes,
it's all character. It's all color.
Yes, and that is so much harder to do as a writer because without a plot to entice people or like a mystery, you really have to be good at that to make people engaged. And J.R. Lansdale is amazing at it. Jim Thompson was amazing at it as well, but there's so few.
Yeah. It's kind of, well, and again, I don't want to equate myself at all to any of these kind of guys. On some of my better stories that I've done, it's coming up with a very simple plot. Obviously, I'm not a very smart guy. I don't do very complicated plots. But giving myself enough room to have a plot and then string moments along that move the plot. But in between those moments, it's when I'm thumbnailing the story that I kind of just wander off into whatever odd visuals or strange little conversational bits. But I have a skeleton to lay this across. And the ones that have worked best are ones where I did zigzag all over the place and go down some odd paths. But again, had the structure of a ongoing story that I knew where I had to end up. So yeah, I'd like to think that without knowing what the fuck I was doing, I'd like to think I did a couple things like that.
No, and I could, you absolutely have as a reader. I can agree with that. And those are the things too, that I look at when I think of Kirby and the influence on people like yourself or someone like Paul Chadwick, especially thinking of the Thing stuff. The things I think of are not the Thing, you know, smashing stuff and doing action. It's him like reading the paper and smoking a cigar, like having to do
eating pancakes.
Yes, yes, exactly.
The image, when you say the Thing, the first image that pops into my head is him eating pancakes because somehow he's got a fork that can pick up like 36 pancakes right at the same time. And his mouth can open wide enough to eat 36 pancakes in a bite.
But also, this guy who does normal stuff like we do, trapped in a monster body, is that sadness that you were talking about earlier, where it's not quite the wish fulfillment of I'm Superman. It's sure you're strong, but also this is really sad.
He did spend a lot of time moping about being the Thing.
That's
yeah.
True.
He was actually like not my favorite comic book character. I know a lot of people, you know, maybe because even as a kid looking at him going, man, he'd be a bitch to draw.
Yes.
I somehow discounted him. But I like the stretching guy.
Oh yeah. Mr. Fantastic. Although I would always, as a kid who liked to draw, be like, oh man, I can't figure out how this is going to work. I mean, Hulk was fun to draw.
Oh, yeah. I thought the Hulk turned out, because that was one of my first gigs,
right.
The Hulk turned out to be a shitload harder to draw than I thought he was going to be.
Oh, why? Was there a specific reason or a thing that you were like, oh my God?
I think because you want to exaggerate all the anatomy, but he's also a compressed shape.
Right.
And somehow I had to fit together. I mean, I can draw him better now, I'm sure, but I had a hard time. But back then I didn't know how to draw anything, so everything was hard.
So I won't take up your whole afternoon, but I'm curious, did you, as a comic fan, even though you were getting out of them, by the time the sort of late 70s came around and you were starting to work in comics, were you watching any of the television stuff we had at that time? Because that was until the 21st century, you know, and maybe the Burton Batman movie, the best we were getting was those two Captain America TV movies and the Incredible Hulk show and Wonder Woman.
I remember vaguely the Hulk show. The Captain America movies I didn't see, or if I saw them, they didn't register.
Yeah.
I do, you know, it's funny. I remember, because my brothers and I, when, you know, there was a comic book store in downtown Oakland, and it was like an hour walk from our house to get there. So we would pilgrimage down there on a Saturday afternoon. Mm-hmm. We'd walk down to the comic book store and walk back. And I remember walking back and fantasizing about, can you imagine if they could ever make a movie or a decent toy of any of these characters? Because it was just something you could never imagine.
Of course.
And then, yeah, you saw this stuff on TV, you know, you see the Captain America with the motorcycle helmet, you know, and go, well, they're certainly never going to make it. Wasn't there some dreadful Spider-Man movie?
Yes.
Where he's, you know, and you just go, well, they'll never do it. They'll, you know, it can't be done. I remember, and again, this is jumping ahead years, but when we saw that second Terminator movie,
mm-hmm.
and that with the liquid metal guy, that's what, and I think I saw it, it was after hours at the San Diego Comic Book Convention, and I don't know who I saw it with, but I remember saying to people, just saw that movie, and yep, they can do anything.
Yep.
Not that they're going to put us out of business, but everything's going to change because they can now do anything. Whereas as a kid, you just couldn't imagine. But to mention the superhero stuff, the stuff that did make a huge impression was those cartoons as a little kid. Because there was an afternoon Captain Satellite, Channel 2, Captain Satellite, some guy in a spacesuit,
yep.
who introduced, you know, the old Marvel cartoons.
The Marvel marching superhero, those ones.
Oh, and I remember, man, I tell you, I get a warm feeling if I replay the theme music. They're dreadful.
Yep.
I've seen little bits and pieces. I've never watched a whole one. But again, even the emotional impact of certain scenes, you know, and again, for whatever reason, why am I fixated on like the, oh no, Lady Dorma's going to die,
yes.
kind of moments. Those made a big impression.
It's big stakes. It's big stakes with characters that you're familiar with. And I think even as a kid, you know, seeing these things 2D flat in a comic and seeing them moving at all was
yeah.
just this extra. We were like, oh, this is crazy. Like even the, you know, the Ralph Bashke's 67 Spider-Man, which is really not great aside from the music. I still enjoy watching that because it does look like sort of Ditko comics in some places just come to life. And there's like a thrill to that I can't quite verbalize.
Well, I also think that they were so earnest, you know, they were so, they took the material serious. At least that's the way they hit me as a kid, because again, the Captain America stuff was the World War II era Captain America stuff, which
yep.
to me is when Captain America works best. So if you're going to do, you know, the sleeper storyline with Captain America, it was just huge. It was dramatic. And I think there's one where, you know, Captain America thinks his girlfriend's been killed or something. It's just, it's real. Yeah, just gut level punch stuff.
Or if I think of like
those were big.
The Fleischer Superman cartoons, which look amazing and are terrible stories.
Yeah.
But to that's like sort of the Batman the Animated Series stuff, or the stuff that like Dini and Tim were doing. It's almost like, let's make those Superman cartoons, but how we remembered them being good.
Well, that's the trick to that stuff, is let's not look back at them. Let's run the film footage that's in our head and not try to create, you know, based on what they really were. Yeah, the Fleischer stuff, it's very cool looking. I probably saw one or two of them as a kid, but I've never really been much of an animation guy. I've always been a live action guy when it comes to that kind of stuff.
Oh, interesting. So is there anything you've been watching now, anything in lockdown or anything that you've revisited that, you know, we've obviously Dark Shadows for a little bit, but anything that surprised you or a comfort show?
No, it's weirdly what I watch a lot, because I'm a DVD guy.
Right.
Thriller was something I hadn't seen. But that was pre-lockdown.
Boris Karloff hosted
an Elijah show. Yeah, I had never seen those. So that was like maybe the last thing. And you know, I finally watched all the Twilight Zones. But again, that's going back a few years. But those things that you'd kind of, Thriller I'd never even heard of.
Right.
So that was just like a revelation. But then, you know, Twilight Zone, to finally watch that stuff. And that's the kind of stuff I can watch now. Lockdown, for whatever reason, I've been watching like British crime shows.
New ones?
I find something very comforting. When I find that there's 10 seasons of one of those British crime shows, I'm like, well, I'm fine.
Yeah.
I barely pay attention to who did what. It's just having that comfort thing of the returning characters talking to each other. I've always worked the TV on.
Yeah.
And as my concentration isn't as good as it used to be when I was younger, I find I can usually not watch new stuff. Can't watch new movies when I'm working. I mean, I can, it just means
working
stuff.
Yeah.
But I can always watch, you know, even, well, I can always watch old Boris Karloff movies, because I find Karloff's voice very soothing. Mm-hmm. Same with Bela Lugosi, but to a lesser extent. But that's just the comfort zone stuff. Putting on those old things, film noir films, which most of which I have never seen before, but I can kind of just run them as background noise. They're not terribly distracting, and it's just listening to those voices, and that kind of imagery is just a very good kind of soothing comfort thing, and it'll get me to sit at the drawing table. I will pace around and look at other stuff, and finally I say, dude, you got to put a movie on, or heaven forbid, you got 10 seasons of some old TV show, put that on, and that will keep you at the drawing table.
Yeah, it sort of sets an atmosphere and sort of pulls your focus just enough away from every distraction to be able to put it on something else.
Yeah, and again, like the crime stuff, it's just they're not terribly distracting.
Right. Are you watching old, like Poirot, or are you watching like stuff like Cracker or The Bridge and that stuff?
Lately I've been watching Vera.
Okay.
Which is almost like it's not Miss Marple, but it's
in the 20s like, or something, right?
No, it's contemporary, but it's just this gnarly, tough detective woman solving crimes. I'm not going to watch Murder, She Wrote.
Right.
That's too funky. And the Poirot stuff I've got, and I've watched a little bit. It has never really quite hooked me. But that is the kind of stuff, that crime of the week kind of stuff that I find just comforting to listen to.
And it's also, you know, they'll solve it every week. Like it's not going to be Twin Peaks.
You know? Yeah. And the good shows, there's enough of a backstory to the characters that kind of continues to evolve from season to season. I just, hit a snag on this show, Vera, where suddenly between season 4 and season 5, they changed a bunch of cast members. I'm like, oh no, what happened to those other people? Where did they go? You didn't write them out. They just suddenly, she's got different people she's working with. Right. You know, that takes some getting used to.
Yeah, just, I always think about that in like comics or something, where just, even if you have different artists drawing a person, you know, a character, they look the same, but it'll just be like, we've recast them. No, they look totally different.
Yeah, that is why when I'm using different artists, especially in longer stories, I'm always trying to work in a scene where we flash back to something from a previous episode, a previous issue. So the new artist gets to draw that same scene. It's just my way of saying, no, it's okay. We're still talking about the same thing. It's not a completely new thing. It might be a completely different artist, but we're talking about the same stuff. Look, here's his version of that scene. So it's okay.
Oh, that's I never noticed you doing that because it's so seamless until you've just mentioned it. I'm like, that is actually pretty brilliant.
It's also a gag I use repeatedly so people think, oh, all these things are connected. He had this thing all worked out from the very beginning. We're constantly coming up with stuff. We're going, ooh, if we do this, it's going to look like we figured that out 20 years ago. We look brilliant, except we just made it up right now.
Long con, man. I've been planning this for 25 years. I got a big, huge board on my wall.
Well, I mean, the big advantage with what I've been doing is that there's been one writer, or there's been like 3 or 4 different writers, but I'm always involved. Whereas Marvel Comics, what was always frustrating to me is every time there was a new writer, suddenly the Submariner doesn't want to be in Atlantis anymore. Right. Now he wants to be this, or now he wants to be that. And it seemed like so many of the writers would come in, and the first thing they'd do is say, well, whatever that last guy wrote, none of that ever happened.
Right.
Or, you know, we're never going to allude to that again. Whereas I haven't felt the need to go back and, you know, I've written some stuff that I wince at, but I've never felt the need to go back and say, oh, well, that never happened.
Right, right. Or, and you'd also,
we may never talk about it again, but I'm not going to go out of my way to say it never happened.
Right. You may, and you're not getting an editor who's going to make you write a big crossover event all of a sudden into your storyline you've been working on for a year.
That is the advantage to owning your own material, is that, you know, the editor basically checks my spelling.
Yeah. I mean, I remember reading the Alan Moore Swamp Things, and he had to, which sounds crazy now, but it's like they made Alan Moore do an invasion crossover and something about crisis in his Swamp Things story, which he did brilliantly. But I'm like, that, you just, even telling someone that happened, they'd be like, there's no way that happened.
Well, one of the writers that worked with me early on the BPRD, one of the reasons I got him to leave DC to go work on my stuff was I can't remember what series he was writing, but every issue or every other issue, it would be, oh, but now you have to do something that crosses over with this. And he could never get his own storyline going because he was constantly saying, yeah, but now we have to cross over with this and cross over with that. And I said, how about you come over here and I leave you alone?
Yeah, I mean, which is why I love, like, one of the other things I first saw of your work was Gotham by Gaslight. And I was so fed up with the continuity stuff that those Elseworlds, which I don't even think it was called then, were brilliant.
Right.
Because it didn't matter. It wasn't connected to anything, but you were still getting the essence of a character.
Yeah, I ran into that with, you know, when I was at Marvel, I only did 3 issues of the Hulk, but this whole
Secret Wars?
Secret Wars thing was going on. And I remember I was in the middle of drawing my third issue of the Hulk, and because everything was so late with the Secret Wars stuff, I remember I got a note or a phone call or whatever saying, oh, you have to add this crossover bit, this 4 pages extra thing onto your new comic, right? So I'm you know, whatever, the one I'm working on, add these 4 pages. And I'm like, yeah, but those 4 pages completely negate what we just did in the issue before.
Right.
And I remember the note from Jim Shooter, or the word I got back from Jim Shooter was, well, then that issue that's completely drawn, just redo it.
Oh.
And I was like, wait, it's finished. And you're saying to make these four pages work, we throw away an entire comic that's finished? Fortunately, my editor went in, and I had one of those editors who would actually go in and argue with Jim.
Right.
But it was just that idea that this is what comics are now. It's just everything is a string of connected stuff. So if you're following this storyline, we're going to trick you into buying everything else.
Yep.
And that was one of the things I think we've stuck to this with all the Hellboy stuff. I said, well, when we do these spin-off books, I never want to start a storyline in one story that finishes in another book. I want, and if somebody just wants to read Hellboy, I want them to be able to just read Hellboy. If somebody just wants to read Lobster Johnson, I want them to just be able to read Lobster Johnson. If the more they read, the more they see of the big picture and the world, but at no point will it be, this storyline continues over here in a book you didn't want to buy.
Yeah, and it's to like sort of what you're saying when we started, where, you know, well, that makes money, you know, and that isn't how you should build stories, you know, when you do these crossovers. And comics is the only world I can think of where they got away with that, although obviously the influence of comics on the movies recently has changed that. But I don't think I've ever watched a TV show where they were like, and for part two of the A-Team, make sure you watch Remington Steele tomorrow.
Well, it's my fear with what I hear about, like with a lot of these Marvel shows that are coming up now, is that you really need to know everything.
Yeah.
You need to have seen all the movies. And even, you know, and again, I haven't seen the TV shows, but watching the movies, it's kind of like, oh, that's right. I have to remember that this movie takes place before this movie, which is why the Black Panther is in this. And it's falling down that it's following the comic book model.
Yeah.
And I remember saying at one time, you know, talking to whoever was editor in chief, I think Tom DeFalco at the time, and he was talking, they were building all this stuff like that. And I said, don't you realize the problem is, your reader, to some extent, your reader is going to feel like it's obvious that you're tricking them into buying stuff they don't want.
Right.
And if they ever come to the point, as Marvel, because Marvel's publishing more and more stuff, if they ever realize they don't have to read everything, they might realize they only need to read 5 books. Right. You're trying to get them to read 40 books, and they might suddenly wake up one day and say, you know what, I only really care about 3 of them.
Yeah.
And that's a problem.
Yeah, I mean, even when I was an avid comics reader, and they'd reference something, and you'd get that thing where it was like, you know, see Fantastic Four issue 141, or, you know, the little references they'd have in there, I would always be like, oh, I have to do homework now.
Yeah, or heaven forbid, you go, oh, I don't have that comic.
Yeah.
Where am I going to find that comic?
Yeah.
I
mean, my big complaint is that because of that, we'll never get my dream show, which is a Evel Knievel-style 70s set Ghost Rider.
Oh. Well, who knows? I mean, the thing is, God knows, at this point, there are 60 trillion channels.
True.
Apparently no end of money to make TV shows.
Yes.
And, you know, you just have to be in the room with... A guy has to come along who's a hot director or a producer who is, well, I don't know if you're going to find anybody who's old enough to remember the cool
right.
Evel Knievel toy. But if there was such a guy and he was suddenly in power, you might get that.
We need a 2021 James Whale who can make his own, do whatever he wants for one thing.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you know, and maybe that's who Del Toro is. I mean,
yeah.
Del Toro is one of those guys who, you know, is successful enough that he gets to make movies where you go, what was the meeting like for that movie? Nobody wanted that movie, but Del Toro is Del Toro, and he could get people to do things that ordinary people wouldn't.
Yeah, he always, I mean, he got them to remake one of those 70s movies that was one of the TV movies that, to your point when we started here, that everyone talked about for years. the Don't Be Afraid of the Dark, which was people remember it was this TV movie and there were little monsters and they lived in the fireplace.
And everybody talks about that movie. If I saw it, it didn't leave any impression.
Wow.
I've still never seen it. Because again, it's like one of those ones where you go, I could go back and watch it now, but if I didn't see it then,
it's
like this other movie everybody talks about, Gargoyles.
Oh, yes.
Didn't see it back then. Or there was a Scarecrow movie. Didn't see it back then.
Yep. Night of the Scarecrow. Dark Night of the Scarecrow. That movie is horrifically sad. I can't watch it because I saw it as a kid, and it's so sad.
Well, isn't it? Yeah, I mean, maybe I did see that one, because it isn't like they basically kill a guy and string him up as a scarecrow.
Yes.
Yeah.
A developmentally disabled guy. He's almost like Lenny of a Mice and Men type character, and he's sort of falsely accused of a thing, and they kill him, and he comes back from the dead. But it's like that, seeing that as a kid, just that opening, I was like, I'm devastated now. I tried to rewatch, and I don't know if you've revisited The Outer Limits at all, but the episode, the Architects of Fear with Robert Culp.
Outer Limits is one I've still never seen most of them.
They are great. And this one, if you like sad, The Architects of Fear, and this won't ruin it for you, but essentially what happens is it's what Moore was influenced his ending from Watchmen. He kind of took it from this, where these scientists decide they're going to fake an alien invasion to sort of unite the Earth. But the way they do it is they have these tiny little alien creatures that they got on a moon mission, and they've realized they can take its DNA and turn one of them into a monster, like a giant size one. And they need to do this. And Robert Culp literally pulls the short straw. And the whole episode is him turning into this monster. And he's got a wife and kids. And the whole thing of like, when is he no longer him? And it disturbed me as a kid. And it's only so much sadder now. I rewatched it and it just broke my heart.
I know I've got the box set around here someplace. And yeah, because I've never been a science fiction guy, I did have to watch the Xanthi Misfits one.
Yes.
Because all you have to do is see a picture of that thing and you go, okay, that I have to see. But for the most part, I haven't seen them.
The two Harlan Ellison ones are worth watching too, that he sued about Terminator for, that they ripped him off, which is Demon with a Glass Hand and Soldier. Those are really good.
I will have to put my complete loathing of Harlan Ellison aside to watch those.
Yeah, no, I hear you. But the stories themselves are incredible. Yeah. Especially if you're a Terminator fan, you're like, oh, okay.
Yeah, it's my Harlan Ellison experience. I'm usually pretty good at distancing myself from the people and the work. I had the misfortune of just encountering Harlan three times in 24 hours. And as somebody pointed out, at least you got it over within a day. You got the entire range of Harlan Ellison experiences, every possible Harlan Ellison experience you managed to get in three encounters within 24 hours. So just be glad you got it over with fast.
You're not the only person I've heard things like that from about.
Yeah.
But there we are. Well, thank you so much for doing this. I really appreciate you taking the time and doing the homework and everything as well.
Oh, It was just so weird looking at an old TV guide. And really that idea of how much is compressed within a relatively short period of time.
Yeah.
Because I did, I think I had the range of like 70 to 72 with the TV guides that you sent. And so I saw Dark Shadows was on at 4, and then I saw a little teaser for the Brady Bunch. And I went, not Brady Bunch, but like Partridge Family. Yeah. I went, oh, shit. They're within a 2 or 3 year period.
You don't think of those two shows existing in the same shared universe.
No, because one takes place in the pre-color days, and one takes place is in the all the colors days.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, that especially that time in history, that late 60s into the early 70s, when you did have that transitional time, culturally as well, the TV from then is crazy. And, all the made-for-TV movies that people tend to talk about come from that era as well, like The Night Stalker and Trilogy of Terror. I mean, they all happen to be Dan Curtis, but
Trilogy of Terror is the movie that I remember everybody talking about.
Yes.
And probably talking about for years. And again, it's one of those movies, I have no desire to rewatch it because I just it can't hold a candle to the impression it made as a kid.
And everyone always only remembers one of the stories.
Yeah. Yeah. I feel bad for the other ones because
a trilogy of one.
Oh,
and just before I let you go, because it would bother me, are you willing to share how Gilligan's Island disturbed you? You teased that.
Oh, I'm glad you brought that up. I won't say it's ruined Shakespeare for me, or Hamlet in particular, but there is an episode of Gilligan's Island, and again, I have no recollection of any of the other plots on Gilligan's Island, but on one episode, they stage a musical production of Hamlet. And I can still hear the song. And it's a nothing scene in Hamlet. It's a, you know, Hamlet, I'm giving you fatherly advice as you go off. Or it's not even Hamlet. It's like one of the other characters is going off to college, you know. never a borrower or a lender be. Do not forget, stay out of debt. It's a musical number in Gilligan's Island. And every time I watch any production of Hamlet, as soon as that scene's in there, it cuts to Gilligan's Island in my head. So which probably my first experience of Shakespeare was on Gilligan's Island.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of people, there's a famous episode of Moonlighting where they do a Shakespeare episode. And a lot of people I talk to, they're like, that was the only Shakespeare I knew for like 20 years.
Like, yeah. All right. It's, you know, it's, yeah. That's at least you got some Shakespeare.
That's true. It's better than none.
I don't know if they're using it anymore.
No,
but,
I don't think How I Met Your Mother did a Shakespeare episode or
no.
Any other
Golden Girls countries. Maybe. But
yeah, I mean they
I don't
might,
know.
They probably what did else? Macbeth. actually, that would have been awesome.
yeah, well, cool. Probably wouldn't have been on my radar.
No, not at all. Well, thank you so much for great talking to you.
My pleasure. I'm glad I took notes and I'm glad I did my homework.
That's Mike. If you're unfamiliar with his work for some strange reason, get familiar with it. There's a billion things you can read. I will send you links. If you don't know where to start, just shoot me an email or hit me up on social media and I will give you some suggestions. But a good dude and super talented, and I am very grateful that he took the time to guest on my show. Anyway, we'll have more guests on the show next week, so I hope to see you then on a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
Later, she's either dead of a heart attack or her hair's turned white. I don't remember. And then I remember something about Cliff and dead sheep. You know, the rest of it's kind of a blur.